Good morning, fellas.
Good morning.
All right, we're going to try to have a good time. We're going to try to learn something about the biology of addiction. All right, my name is Dallas Bennett. I'm one of the counselors here. And I'm going to try to explain something that's very complicated and try to keep it real simple. All right, so have you ever asked yourself a question of, why can't I say no to this invisible magnet pulling me and making me do something I promised I'd never do again?
Yeah.
And that's the one thing that comes out of this class, sincerely, is that it answers that why question. You know, why couldn't I stop? Why couldn't I quit doing this? Even though you really didn't want to use drugs or drink to the point where it's causing you all these crazy problems with yourself and your family, why couldn't I say no? Because that's the cool thing for me, is hopefully it will answer that question. And then it will explain it in a way that will really help you be released of a lot of shame and guilt. Because some of you know, deep down in your heart, you wouldn't have done the things that you did, right? In your right state of mind. You wouldn't have said some of the things that you said in your right state of mind. So that's what we're going to do this morning, is try to talk to you a little bit about the biology of addiction and how it works in our brain. All right, so our brain is basically made of two parts, the top part and the bottom part. And I know it's made of a lot of different parts, right?
Right.
And we can get real complicated with it, and it gets very confusing, and then I'll be mixed up, and I'll mess you up. So I'm going to try to keep it real simple. There's a top part and a bottom part. The top part is the neocortex, which is the real you. Okay? The bottom part we refer to as the midbrain. And that's where the beast lives. We'll talk about that a little bit later. The top part of the brain is what separates us from being a horse or a cow or a dog. Okay? The top part of the brain is the real you. It's the part of you who wants to be a good father, good husband, good wife, right? Good mother, those kind of things. Alright, so it's a part of the top part of our brain is a part of us that wants to plan for a vacation, take the kids to Disney World, go camping, whatever. That's the top part of our brain that plans. Alright? Top part wants to have happiness and joy and peace. Alright? The bottom part of our brain referred to as the midbrain. The midbrain is created for one reason. What is it?
Survival.
Right, survival. The midbrain is created for survival. The midbrain is where we get the automatic functions. It controls our automatic functions of our body. Keeps our eyes blinking, heart beating, right?
Mm-hmm.
Keeps our lungs going. The midbrain is what keeps us alive. It's the animalistic part of our brain. Alright? I refer to it as it and you. And, you know, distinguishing the difference, understanding the difference is going to be real important in understanding what really truly is addiction. Alright, see that little black dot right there?
Yeah.
What is that?
Hippocampus.
Right. It's a little pump, and every human being has one. And that little pump, okay, is full of what?
Chemicals.
Very good, exactly. That little pump is full of chemicals. Okay, so let's blow that pump up, right? And then what does it look like? It looks kind of like a little snot sucker. Little thing that you put in the baby's nose and clean the baby's nose out with. Okay? Let's blow it up and it kind of looks like this. Okay? Everything we do as a human being, that pump gets stimulated and out comes what?
Chemicals,
right. So pretty much everything we do as human beings, boom, boom, that little pump shoots out chemicals and it gives us what?
Feelings.
Feeling. Every kind of feeling you can imagine from A to Z. Angry, agitated, frustrated, happy, sad, pleasure, whatever it may be. Good or bad. You get these feelings, these are called neurotransmitters. These chemicals get pumped out and it gives us a feeling. Everybody say feelings real loud and real slow.
Feelings.
Nothing more than
feelings.
That's not stupid, sorry. Alright, so everything, alright, somebody give me an idea of, what's your favorite food?
Pizza. Steak.
Okay, steak, pizza.
Lobster. Macaroni and cheese.
Lobster, okay. Macaroni and cheese.
Cheeseburger.
Alright, so when you eat good food, right, it gives you a sense of pleasure. Okay, so now, based on the information you have here, the little handouts they give you, what chemical is released out that gives you pleasure?
Dopamine.
Okay, dopamine. Dopamine gives you what kind of feeling?
Pleasure.
Exactly. Okay, so you get a little dopamine rush when you eat a good ribeye or some lasagna or fried chicken or whatever you like, you know? All right. What's the next chemical?
Serotonin.
All right, serotonin. Okay, what does serotonin do for you? What kind of feeling does that give you when it comes out?
Sleepy.
Okay, that's how we go to sleep as a human being. Okay, basically serotonin pumps out that little pump, right? Everybody say, there you go. That little pump releases serotonin and we go to sleep. Now this is naturally how our pump and our midbrain and neocortex is supposed to work. Okay, so if you can get sleep in here, you know, lysol's out, had a big food in our stomach, we'd all start getting sleepy so that it starts shooting out serotonin. And we start going to sleep. Okay? If you have minor sleep problems, that's all that's going on, you don't have enough serotonin pumping out. Anyway, we'll talk about that a little bit later. Is that cool?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
All right. This is naturally how it's supposed to work. Now, what's the next one?
Endorphins.
Okay, now what does endorphins do for you?
Pain relief.
Right. Endorphins is a natural pain reliever. Okay, that chemical's in our pump. So if you're at home and you're putting a picture up on the wall and you're hammering, you know, bam, you hit your finger, you're like, crap, it hurts, you know? It hurts, your midbrain pump starts releasing what?
Endorphins,
trying to numb the pain as much as possible. And that's basically how it works. Some of you are runners, anybody runners?
Yeah.
Hey, you get the runner's high, second wind. Anybody know about that?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what's going on. It's not that you're really getting, you know, a second wind. It's that it's causing so much pain to your body that it starts releasing more endorphins, therefore numbing the pain, and you don't really, you know, it doesn't hurt as much, so you're able to kind of get going and get a kick in. You can get a little endorphin high out of it too, right?
Right.
You guys like to exercise a lot? That's what's going on. That's a natural pain reliever. Everybody with me?
Yeah.
All right, what's the next one?
GABA.
Okay, what is GABA?
Anti-anxiety.
Okay, right, GABA is an anti-anxiety chemical. Okay, let's say that we're walking through the woods and a snake runs out on us. And we get away from it. What helps us get away from it?
GABA.
No? Tricked you up a little bit.
Epinephrine.
And we understand that as adrenaline.
Fight or flight.
Okay, it's adrenaline. Adrenaline, epinephrine is what?
Fear.
It's a fight or flight. Freeze. Okay? We're either going to stand up and fight, or we're either going to freeze in fear, or we're going to fly, we're going to run away. Okay, that's all about the epinephrine. But once we get away from that snake, and we start trying to calm down, what starts kicking in?
GABA.
GABA is the anti-anxiety. GABA is a neurotransmitter that's shooting out of our brain, trying to keep us from not going into a panic attack or an anxiety attack.
Freaking out,
exactly. So like some of you may have anxiety issues. If you do, you just don't have enough GABA pumping, basically.
That's right.
You know, your pump might be a little low of GABA. Anyway. And the last one's what?
PIP.
PIP is an acronym for a $50 word I can't spell or pronounce, so I just put PIP up there. All right? But PIP gives you the feeling of what?
Caring, love, and relationship.
Okay, caring, love, compassion. Okay, that's that feeling that we get from the neurotransmitters, you know, pumping in. Everybody cool?
Yeah.
Everybody see how it's naturally supposed to work?
Right.
All right, now let's talk about how we can kind of screw this thing up. Now, let me ask you kind of a out-of-the-box question, all right? Does cocaine make a human being high?
No.
Now, for the sake of this video, you know, I know you guys know the right answer, so just hang with me on that, all right? But for the guys watching on the video, they're probably going to say, yeah, cocaine makes a person high. Does alcohol make a person drunk?
Yes.
Okay?
Sure.
Yeah, hang on. Okay? Alcohol, cocaine, marijuana, pain pills, seriously, they do not make people high or drunk. Alcohol does not make a person drunk. Cocaine does not make a person high. Okay? Cocaine is just a plant. Now stay with me. I'm sharing something kind of outside the box here, but it's important because I need you guys to understand the biology of addiction. Okay, cocaine is a plant. It's a coca plant, so we can harvest that plant, crush it up, manipulate it, put it in our body. Okay, what happens is when we put that cocaine in our body, it runs through our system, right, and hits that pump and releases an unnatural amount, of dopamine. Now it releases a lot of other chemicals too, but mainly dopamine. That's where we get the unnatural euphoric high. It's that you know, God didn't create our pump to release that much dopamine. All right, everybody say, okay? It's an unnatural amount of dopamine. Now, what scientists tell us, that a whole lot smarter than me, they tell us that the first time a person uses crack or, say, meth too, that stimulant, that it releases the amount of dopamine as if a person had a 10-minute orgasm. Now, that's a long time.
Yes,
you know, that's a lot of dopamine being rushed out. Now, I like to share that because it gives people an understanding of the pleasure centers and what's going on with the chemistry in our brain. It's crazy. It's an unnatural amount. Okay? All right, so let's take alcohol. Alcohol really doesn't make a person drunk. Okay, alcohol is just barley, wheat, and yeast, and hops, and sugar. Right? All mixed together. Let it set for a while. Some of it we let set a little bit longer. Okay? But if you take that Mad Dog, or that Slits, or that Wild Turkey, or, right? Boone's Farm, I don't know if they make Boone's Farm anymore.
12:45.
You know? Take that wine, it doesn't matter. Alcohol is alcohol is alcohol. If you take that alcohol and you put it in your body, alcohol runs through your system, right, and hits that pump. And it'll release a whole bunch of dopamine at first, because that's where we get the buzz from. Okay? That's where we get the little buzz, the abundance of dopamine rushing. But what happens, it's followed by massive amounts of serotonin. Right? Massive amounts of serotonin. Why serotonin?
It's calm you down.
Why is it a depressant? Okay? Just keep it real simple. Just biology. When you drink alcohol, it pumps out dopamine at first, because that's where you get the buzz from, happy, but followed by massive amounts of serotonin.
Pass out, fall down.
Because remember, what does serotonin do for us? Makes you go to sleep. Calms you down. Okay, so if you're drinking, right? You're drinking, all of a sudden you're drinking, you're getting an overload of what?
Serotonin.
You're drinking. If you drink too much, you're going to start doing what?
Passing out.
Right. You're going to start passing out. You're going into a coma. The first stages of death. That's what's happening. When you're drinking, you're releasing an unnatural amount of serotonin. And that serotonin is flooding your system. And if you get too much serotonin, you're going to pass out. You're literally going into a coma. The first stages of death. That's one of the main reasons people die from alcohol. Is they get an overload of serotonin, they go into a coma, and the heart stops. Dead. A lot of these kids now, these college kids are doing this. It's funneling, right? They funnel it down, they get so much alcohol in their system before their midbrain can shut down, that they get too much serotonin, and they go into a coma and die. Okay? One of the other leading causes of alcohol death is to drown on your own puke. Then there's alcohol poisoning, all kind of other stuff. Alcohol is the number one drug problem in America. At this point right now, 25% of all emergency room visits are drug and alcohol related. And mainly alcohol. Alcohol destroys more of your organs and your body than any other drugs. Okay? All right? Endorphins, Lortab, Percocet, Oxycontin, whatever you want to take, fentanyl. Okay? It really doesn't numb pain. Okay, you take a Lortab, it runs through your system, hits that pump, and releases what?
Endorphin.
Endorphin. This is endorphins running through there and numbing the pain. Y'all get it?
Yeah.
It's the endorphins.
The heroin too?
Anything, yep. Heroin, thank you. Any opiates. Whether synthetic or natural, where it foams down from the plant, right?
Right.
What plant? Yeah, the opiates, right? Poppies. All right, so here we go. Endorphin, same thing. It's just endorphin releases the, you know, the opiates release the endorphins. Endorphins run through there and numb the pain. Okay, the same way. Anybody know anybody that cut themselves, like self-mutilators? Why do they do it?
Release endorphins.
Release endorphins. They do it the same reason you take Lortabs or abuse drugs, smoke meth, crack, whatever. Same reason, because they're getting an endorphin rush, or serotonin, or dopamine, or whatever. Whatever drug applies here. But basically, especially in my career, I've been doing this 21 years now, and in my career, I've seen a lot of young women, right, especially, who self-mutilate and cut themselves. Most times it's because they've been sexually abused sometime in their past. And so they realized and found out through cutting themselves, it releases endorphins, makes them feel better, just like you taking a handful of Lortab, right? Releases endorphins, makes them feel better. But then what happens, you can get addicted to self-mutilating. Seriously, you can get addicted to it. Okay? You build up a tolerance for it just like anything else. Mm-hmm. GABA. Okay, what about GABA? Anti-anxiety, you know? Okay, you can buy GABA. Anyway, we'll talk about that in a minute. In a local pharmacy, drugstore, vitamin herb shop. You can get most all. Alright, this is a real important part right here. Alright? Everybody look at my hands. Okay? It's up and down. Happy, sad. This is the way your midbrain pump goes. Okay, some days you're up, some days you're sad, that sort of thing. Okay, you ride a roller coaster, your midbrain pump releases a chemical, gives you a feeling, and it fills right back up. That's the way it's designed. Have sex, gives you a feeling, fills right back up. Right on down.
This is natural?
Mm-hmm, this is naturally how it works. You catch a fish, you guys like fishing?
Yeah.
Catch
yeah.
a big fish. It releases a chemical, gives you a feeling, and then it fills right back up. That's the way the midbrain pump was created for. To replenish itself right away and fill right back up. Because we're human beings, we have feelings, right? Emotions. Right? Now, somewhere down the line, we decided to put outside substances into our body. Okay? When you're real young, whenever you decide to do that, okay, you put the chemicals in our body, you know, whatever it is, drugs, alcohol, it pumps out way too much. Okay? And it tries to fill back up and doesn't quite get back the way it was. What's going on now?
It's depleting the chemical in the midbrain pump.
Right. Okay? You don't know this when you first start using. You're not aware of all this when you first start using. So what happens is we just do it again. So we pump out and it pumps out way too much. This time it doesn't quite get back the way it was the last time. See what's going on? Okay, you just keep going. You keep using, keep abusing this pump, and it shoots out way too much, tries to fill back up, doesn't quite get back the way it was the last time. What's going on now? It's getting lower. It's getting lower and lower and lower. This is literally what happens. Your pump starts getting lower and lower chemicals. It's like going one step forward and two steps backwards. Everybody with me?
Yeah.
Okay, just like your well's getting dry, your pump's getting dry. Because you're pumping way too much out. And it can't fill back up. Okay, you're not allowing it time to fill back up. So what happens? Your pump starts getting lower. It starts getting depleted. Okay, and here's the kicker, guys. Everybody pay attention to this. Once your midbrain pump gets to a certain depletion level, and we're all different because we all have different chemical makeups, but it'll eventually happen. You can't just hit your finger with a hammer every day and just keep doing it on the 23rd day. You're going to cause damage to your finger. It's eventually going to fall off, right? Yeah. You can't keep damaging an organ in your body called this little part of your brain right here, okay? It's a pump. It's not literally a pump, but we're going to call it a pump to make it easier to understand. Your midbrain up here is created for what?
Survival.
Are you with me? Survival. So if your midbrain pump gets to a certain depletion level, okay, it is going to take over. Because it will start feeling like it can't function as a normal human being. Because it literally don't have enough chemicals in there to give you that feeling that you're gonna you can get going. It feels like it's gonna die. Because in the same area of the brain, if you went 3 or 4 days without water, or 30 or 40 days without food, it will just drive you. You, the real you who doesn't want a drinking drug. You don't want anything to do with it. But when your pump gets to a certain depletion level, your midbrain, which was creative survival, it's the animalistic part of our brain, will like override the top part, the rational part of you, and will drive you. It's where that invisible magnet is pulling you and making you do something you promised you'd never do again. Is this making sense?
Yeah.
It's a simple biology. You get that pump depleted to a certain point, and your midbrain beast will kick in, and it will drive you and almost like overtake the rational part of you and kind of make you go get it. This is the tip of the iceberg. This is true addiction. Yes?
When you deplete your levels real low, when you get some lengthened sobriety, does it come back up or not?
Yeah, the question was, will this pump fill back up? Yes, it will. That's the cool part. What scientists tell us now is it takes anywhere from six months to a year before your pump will eventually fill back up with the natural chemicals to get back to whatever your baseline is, whatever your normal is, whatever that means. But it'll get back, but it takes about 6 months to a year. Thus, the importance of surrounding yourself with support, with recovery, the recovery program, support. Because you're going to need it. Because the biggest challenge for most people is biology. It's physical. Because you're kind of here now, you're kind of just in a controlled environment like. But as soon as you get back home, back to your family, back in your environment, and your five senses start kicking in, right? It's gonna activate that midbrain beast which wants the drinking drug. Once that animalistic part of our brain understands what it feels like to have a fifth of wild turkey running through our system, or that cocaine go up your nose, or that needle punching your skin and juicing you up, right? Once that midbrain understands that feeling, you will always remember what it feels like for the rest of your life. As long as you're a human being and you have a brain, you cannot put alcohol and drugs in your body again. You do that one day at a time, which we'll talk about that later. But the biggest part of it is physical at the beginning. It's not necessarily psychological or spiritual or social, which we do understand addiction as a biopsychosocial spiritual problem. But out of those four, the number one that we need to focus on at the very beginning is arresting the midbrain beast. Right? And understanding, that's why we'll get into another class called RAT, Recognizing Addictive Thinking. That's a whole nother class. Yes?
So when it gets really low, that coincides with why we feel withdrawal symptoms, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Because we think that we need that stuff to survive, so without it, we feel absolutely horrible.
Yeah, but the truth is, you actually really do need it. That makes sense. You really do need that dopamine and serotonin and endorphins and GABA to function as a normal human being. Now, this is an interesting twist because think about this. If any of you guys have ever been really deep in your addiction, I'm talking about really cranked up, you're in addiction, and your midbrain is in control, making you do the crazy stuff, right? That's why you hear guys that are peeping out the window, you know, looking for the police or whatever, you know, they, right? They're paranoid because they have no more GABA left. They just smoked it all out, meth or crack. Because if your GABA's low, right, you're going to be what?
Anxious.
You're going to be anxious. You're going to be very anxious. And if your GABA's really, really low, you're going to be paranoid. And in other words, you're going to look like, you know, paranoid schizophrenia, right? You're going to start seeing things and hearing things that really are not there. Shadow people. Right, exactly. Out in the cornfield coming to get me. But basically, I've worked in a psychiatric hospital for 5 years, and bless the hearts, guys that come in, they get misdiagnosed for schizoaffective disorder or some kind of schizophrenia stuff, and I do a little collateral information on the phone and find out they've been smoking meth for 5 years. They come in and get the wrong diagnosis, right?
Yeah.
But their GABA was like bottomed out. No, nothing there to have anxiety, you know, no anti-anxiety. Same thing with alcohol. Guys that come in and say, I'm depressed. I'm thinking in my mind, you're not really depressed. You have no more serotonin left. You done drank it all out. You've been drinking liquor for 5, 10 years, 20 years, right? Because I guarantee you, if your serotonin's low, you're going to be depressed. You're going to be sad. You can have a great job, money in the bank, wonderful family, and if your serotonin's low, you're going to be sad. Period. Right, guys?
Yeah.
Good question, man. Good question. Is this making sense?
Yeah.
Midbrain. Animalistic part of us. The beast brain. I remember the guy that got his arm caught in the mountains?
Yeah.
Remember, he took out his MacGyver knife, man, and sawed his own arm off. How'd he do that?
Midbrain.
Wide open, in control. Midbrain thought he was going to die. You know, we're on a plane, we all crash, we'll be eating each other before it's over with. Our midbrains will kick in, that beast part of us. I know I'm looking kind of good right now. I'm losing some weight. You can eat me first. Same thing, you take a little kind-hearted man, a little sweet kind-hearted man, a little Monopoly man or something, you know? Real nice guy. You know, let his plane crash in the desert. He crawled through the desert about 4 or 5 days. And come up on you, got some nice bottle of water, you know? And you tell him, no, you don't need this water.
Monster.
What would that kind-hearted little man do?
Get that water and take over.
Crack your kennel up with a desert rock, wouldn't he? He'd kill you to get that water. His beast brain would kick in to get that water. Same thing. When you're in addiction and your pump is low, your beast brain takes control over and overrides the rational part of you. All right. Questions real quick. Does this make sense?
Yeah.
You guys understand?